Thank you very much also for bringing me here. It was quite exciting today because I've literally just arrived, I think, 1 and 2 hours ago. I think my plane landed. And I sort of drove through the city with the train and saw through the windows the city fly by that I've never been to. And that I know from reading in the plane, sort of some basic figures, has exactly as many inhabitants as my home country, Switzerland. I live in Germany, but I come from Switzerland. But Switzerland has, I think, 10 times more surface. Is that right, Mr. Consulate? And is nevertheless still panicking that there would not be enough space, is what the right-wing party constantly repeats. And here, Hong Kong is definitely a proof visually that somehow more people are can be together, if or not in productive ways. I don't know. You tell me. But anyway, what I thought, looking out of the window, that it would be nice to maybe start, when I now show some visuals of projects that we've been developing with Rimini Protocol in many different places, with one project where actually what I basically do, or what the audience basically does, is looking out through the window at the city and look at it as theater and try to understand the complexities that in a city like in Hong Kong you experience. It's a project that grew when I went to Bulgaria, so Sofia, a country that I visited before hitchhiking, and I took a lot of hikes with truck drivers, and I was so impressed about how many stories about Europe Bulgarian truck drivers can tell you, because they've experienced all the borders when they were still there, they have experienced all the corruption, they needed to leave money behind on the borders, and they experienced a lot of waiting. And I thought, if I want to tell this story, or if I want them to tell their story, then I need not to bring them to a stage, but I need to have them driving, because whenever a psychologist once told me that he likes to go driving with his patients, because whenever you leave things behind, you start to talk. And so I transformed the truck in such a way. So this is a 2006, way back. I'll come to more recent projects. I transformed this truck in such a way, now you see it from one side, that 50 people can go inside and listen to their stories. It's an old project, so the documentation is not so...
Welcome in Bulgarian.
My name is Savcho. I'm from Bulgaria. I am almost 22 years a professional driver. So, now we are in Sofia. After 1 hour, we can be at the border. We can go.
So he says that now they're in Sofia, but actually they're in Switzerland, in Basel at this point, where the project started. And there's this one fictional layer that this tour that the audience makes through the city is a tour from Bulgaria to wherever we performed the show, in this case Basel. So we had to cross a lot of borders, which gives them an occasion to speak about their biographies that is so deeply connected to the politics of the continent. This is a live camera now.
And then I will start at third gear because the truck now is not loaded. Thank you. Thank you, lady.
Welcome in Sofia. How start? In Bulgarian. So
the theater from outside.
That's in Bulgarian parliament.
So in the beginning we show videos inside, and then where Sofia, Bulgaria was projected, the city is. But the city not where normally pedestrians walk around or where they would know the beautiful side of Basel, but rather the corners where you would go when you're a truck driver. So this is the harbor of, you know that image very well.
I hate Serbia,
the train.
And I'm going to tell you why. Every time when I travel through this country, the Serbian police used to stop me. Look out of the window and see Europa.
So basically, this is a transportable audience space that allows you to stop and have a kind of a ready-made stage outside of the window. Truck drivers would go out and tell about their favorite trucks, or we would go into places where globalization sort of transforms realities. Here, for instance, are furnitures that are produced in Indonesia and then stocked in Basel for a while before they're redistributed all over France. And we somehow managed to stop the truck in there every evening that the show happened for some minutes, and the guy who was working there stopped his work for some seconds, got a microphone, and in 5 minutes explained us what just in time means to him. And you physically could feel the stress of these logistics that you have out there in the Hong Kong harbor.
So Stefan, what they say, like the driver and the factory workers, are the text scripted? What they say is scripted beforehand, or they just improvise on the spot?
Well, they do have, well, it's a process of elaborating together what their story might be. I choose them because of certain stories they have to tell. But then they also associate. In this case, we got into a lot of traffic jams, and so they needed to improvise as well. But they did it along certain guidelines. They would have something to say about any gas station along the way. When you talk to them about Avignon, they would say, Avignon, great city. But not because it's an ancient old city or because it has a beautiful theater festival. They said it's a great city because it has a gas station. If you fill up your tank there, you get a shower for free. And it's sort of... And then they would contrast what their knowledge as truck drivers is with the landscape. We had a singer outside who would sing in a roundabout, and the truck would turn around, and only inside the truck could hear what she was singing.
This is myself. This is my wife. She is Turkish. I speak Turkish because we were together in Cyprus. Now I can speak with many drivers. İyi geceler, iyi akşamlar. Hadi güle güle.
For instance, on this truck stop, we always met. Basel is still not part of the European Union, and it has a long queue every morning waiting for the trucks to be allowed to get through the customs. And they would always walk around and try to find Bulgarian newspapers and start improvised talks just with the people there. On the other hand, it has a dramaturgy that is, because we're not driving from Bulgaria to Switzerland, this would take a week. It's just a 90-minute show happening inside Basel and ending on at the back of the theater again. But they would somehow be able to connect their lives to the streets.
I've eaten more than 25 sandwiches.
Yeah. So this is just some images. Now this was very specifically developed. It's a project that has both ingredients. Some of our projects have a lot of research and try then to fix the text very precisely. Radio Muezzin, for instance, a show that Ki Hong brought to Singapore as well, was a show where we precisely knew what the Muezzins would say on stage, and it was developed in 4 months of rehearsals and diplomatic negotiations about what a Muslim can say on stage that is deeply rooted in religion, and it had subtitles, so they couldn't really improvise. But here, it was a lot about the unforeseeable of theater. The one day you would have rain pouring down, and what you would see outside would be very different from another day where you got into a traffic jam and the show in Warsaw one day suddenly took 3 hours and the truck driver started to sing because they didn't know what to tell anymore. But you had this physical feeling of being stuck in a situation as a truck driver would be in a similar way. So you felt, in a way, also exposed to the kind of power of, yeah, you were sitting where the commodities normally are transported. And the people we found in each city were connected to a kind of a way. It was a lot of research about how to connect. In theater, we talk about the red thread, in German at least. Would you say that, of dramaturgy? Der rote Faden. How would you translate that? Like, it's an expression to say what sort of connects the dramaturgy, what holds it together. Mm-hmm. We talk about the red thread, and it would be very physically a red thread going through the city. And so if you had one interesting location you wanted to show, it didn't work out if it was 20 kilometers off the road. You would need to connect it somehow.
And I think this very first example that Stefan has shown us is the very feature that Rimini Protocol's work has been known for, is that they seldom use professional actors. Instead, they use social actors, if I would say, someone that plays a role in the society, but at the same time, they play a very important role in the work itself. So the very overlapping of the actors, it is meaning as a performer and a social actors, happened in RP's work quite a lot of times. And as we progress, as we move on to see more examples from RP's work, we'll be quite curious to know how you cast that very particular social actors in your works. Let's say in this work, it seems to me that the driver is a very interesting character as a person. Have you been spending a lot of time choosing who will be the one showing up in the work, or is it by pure chance or personal encounter that you bump into a very interesting driver and then you invite him to your cast?
With this project, I literally just posted an ad in the newspaper. I'm looking for truck drivers for a theater project. And many of them applied and said, well, it's no problem, I can drive your stage designs around. That's what they thought. And I said, well, it's not exactly what I want to hire you from, but tell me more about you. And then so they started talking, but they didn't realize that I'm actually listening to it because I wanted to reuse their stories in a way. And it took a lot, long
while. You're very happy
while.
About that.
Well, one of them sort of was fed up with it after half a year, though. And the other one actually got quite... Because some of them, they do the job because they basically want to hit the road and be silent and mute and sort of stare at the road. Mm-hmm. But I found some others who were quite proud about talking. We did this project also in a second version out of Europe. We developed one in Shanghai, where so that's also the one that got closest to Hong Kong so far of our mm-hmm. project. It was a bit complicated because we had a lot of difficulties in bringing the truck into the country. But in the end, when we made it, the truck drivers here were not Bulgarians because they wouldn't have anything to say about China. So we had a migrant worker from a very small village somewhere in the countryside out of, not sure which province it exactly was, but it wasn't at all grown-up Shanghaiese. And we made our way somehow through Pudong district in a very exciting and strange trip, because it was the year of the expo, and it started in this booming city, in this architectures. And halfway through, you could suddenly see where the kind of migrant workers were sleeping, somewhere behind some stores. There were just outdoor places for people to sleep, and this was suddenly in front of the window of the truck, which was quite an impressive turnover. So these projects keep growing when they're developing. But if you want to talk about casting, maybe it makes sense to have a look into one other project that I've developed a while ago, not with Rimini Protocol, but with Argentinian playwright and director Lola Arias. She's from Argentina, and I have spent quite a lot of time in Brazil. And in Brazil, the role of the policeman, in a way, is quite complicated. And I thought it might be interesting to show this in Hong Kong, where you had also quite direct interactions with police in the last years.
Too direct at times.
In Brazil, basically, since the military dictatorship, the police is somebody you might not want to call if you get into trouble. That's at least what the saying goes. On the other hand, the drug gangs that are controlling wide parts of São Paulo or of Rio de Janeiro might also not exactly be the person you want to protect you. And we wondered, who are these police people? And so we started to talk to a lot of Brazilian police and try to convince them to take part in a project. It was really complex because, much different from the truck drivers, we needed, in a way, them to talk about their work and their people that are grown into a world that is highly hierarchical. And so whenever they said they're interested, they said, but I need to ask my boss, and the boss needs to sign a paper, and that boss after a while would come back and say, but I can only allow this if my boss says yes to it, and so on. So we had to take on different forms of collaborations, as you will see. The way the project worked out, again, was not happening on a frontal stage, because we felt the direct interaction with police people would be too, if it was in a distant stage, it was would be very easy for the people to sit back and laugh about them or judge them. But as I wanted to talk about their biographies, I wanted them to be very close. So we invited very small groups of people to walk through a construction site inside the Avenida, a building inside Avenida Paulista, which is the main economical hub in São Paulo, in a 14th floor up there. We found a place that it was being reconstructed. And the groups of six person at a time would first be brought up by through an elevator. I'll skip that part. And then they would look down at the city and first of all just listen to a civil investigator, policeman, who was not allowed to be there in person, but with whom we recorded a bit. Some, actually, what he was talking about when he looks down at Avenida Paulista, how his suspect mechanism in the brain work.
Sou investigador de polícia. Bem-vindos ao 14º andar. Daqui dá para observar bem o que pode ser suspeito na cidade de São Paulo. Primeiro, todo mundo que está com uma mochila nas costas já é suspeito. Até as mulheres. Tem muita mulher aí que se arruma bem tudo para falar. Cometer crime também. Porque o bandido, ele não tem uma cara específica hoje em dia. Como aquele senhor ali, ó, perto do farol, tá vendo? Uma pasta preta na mão, pode ser um traficante que tá levando a droga pra algum desses prédios aqui de rico. E ele vem entregar a droga assim, ó, de terno e gravata. O que faz o carro ser suspeito? Primeiro, os adesivos que tem no carro, né? Num grupo de rap. Porque eu também gosto de rap sendo polícia. Mas o que acontece? Rap é um som mais da classe periférica, né? Que tem a ver com som da violência, da realidade de São Paulo. Porque os bandidos hoje em dia eles têm muitos artifícios. Olha esse senhor também de branco aqui, ó. O que um médico todo de branco tá fazendo com uma pasta preta? Pode ser uma pessoa fingindo com uma roupa de médico. Se fosse pra mim falar, quem você acha que é suspeito desse prédio? Eu ia falar, a pessoa que mora na cobertura. Né? Que é o mais rico. De onde ele tira tanto dinheiro pra ter morar numa cobertura, ainda mais aqui na Paulista? E, ó, o que a gente observa aqui na Paulista, o que que é? É o medo. O medo do crime.
So it was a project where we would meet all together, I think, about 13 different policemen in different forms. Flavia, the second one, you is a person that receives phone calls, and her superior again did not want her to be part of it, but she said she wanted to, so we put her behind a sort of a mirrored window, and she would be on the phone with the people sitting actually just right in front, like in a peep show almost, where you don't see though.
Alô? Todos me escutam bem?
Alô?
Todos estão me escutando?
Sim.
Meu nome é Soldado Flávia, trabalho há mais de 10 anos na polícia, atendo em média 800 ligações diárias. Um certo dia, um homem me liga e fala, não, eu vou me matar, eu vou me matar. Eu vou me matar, eu vou me matar. Qual o seu nome? Não, eu tô ligando pra polícia só pra falar que eu vou me matar. Alguém do grupo já tentou se matar? Não? Você aqui de vermelho, rosa? Alguém do grupo já ligou o 90?
Já.
Qual
já.
Foi o teor da ocorrência?
A gente tava na casa da Flora e a... O vizinho começou a bater na vizinha e quebrar todas as coisas na casa.
E ela começou a chorar muito.
Uhum.
A gente ligou outra vez também. Lembra aquela menina na rua que tava chorando?
It was a project in Brazil. You have to understand there are about four different forms of police. The biggest one is military police. So they have a direct and never really reflected past just 30 years back. That's why they also have a musical corps inside their unit.
Que fala assim, me deem uma banda na frente da minha tropa que eu ganho o mundo.
Is he a policeman? Yes, he is a policeman, but he is working half day as part of the music band of the police, and half day he goes to the street, and the other policeman thinks that he's not a real policeman because he is a musician, but as he will prove, actually the same muscle that he uses to hold the thing, he can use, so he's very strong with this muscle, so he's a very good shooter.
Curiosidade. Isso daqui parece um cano de uma arma. Isso daqui é a empunhadura do revólver. E aqui onde ficaria o gatilho, fica a empunhadura do meu braço. E trabalhando na rua, se aquilo ali fosse um meliante, eu tivesse com a minha .40, tivesse que proteger vocês agora sem muito avisado, o meliante, aliás, teria tomado dois tiros no mesmo lugar e eu teria estourado ele todinho. E vocês não correriam perigo de jeito nenhum. Vocês queiram passar, por gentileza, no próximo estágio?
So room by room in this construction site, you would sort of meet different people. He's an investigator who needs to dress up like gangs so he can take refuge, but he's also a dog trainer. There are two children of a now unemployed policeman who didn't want to do the job anymore because actually they're very badly paid, which is part of the corruption problem then inside the investigating the university at the time. She had a story to tell about the prison. This guy was really tough because he was in that moment being judged for a case of homicide. He had killed somebody actually. He told me always that he was innocent, that he did it in defense. I don't know. I just know that 2 months later he was judged and he was 7 years in jail. And the background of them is often the favela itself. And what I didn't say yet is where the name of the project, Chácara Paraíso, comes from. The biggest military police training camp in South America, which is called... Chácara Paraíso, which would mean like fazenda paradise. And inside that training camp, they have favela simulations where policemen are trained how to kick doors open in the complex architecture of a favela. And we sort of reconstructed within our space a little bit of this setup that they have, which is like a stage design actually, and a lot of our conversations with the police people was actually a conversation about theater, because we both immediately agreed that they are actors being trained in such stage designs, having a text, which is the law, which they can partly fulfill and partly they improvise.
And they have to do rehearsals.
And they have dress, the uniform, and they have their role to fulfill and often struggle with it personally. Mm-hmm. And actually, it turned out a lot of them were very afraid of also meeting the audience, because obviously they know that the people often hate the police. Mm-hmm. And actually at the time there were attacks on policemen on the street where they were shot at, and it was a big question how much, on the other hand, you need in a democracy a police also to interact with. And this guy, who comes from Islam himself and told us that he needed at some point to decide whether he wants to go for the side of the crime or the side of the police, it would basically mean the same thing in the end. He will be badly paid and having a gun and being in life danger. He showed us this video that they watch for encouraging the policemen. That's part of their training as police self-confidence training.
Is it difficult to assess this kind of material? Given the, you know, bureaucratic setup in Brazil.
Well, it was the material actually not, because actually the police people themselves, they have often, there's so much smuggling going on, you know, because they're trafficking basically the weapon that the gangs then use. They are often very directly involved in the drug crimes themselves, and they have no problem to give you materials under the hand. What the only thing that was really complicated is to be officially standing in a theater and having their name on it. So that was the most complex thing in the.
And how much time have you spent on really convincing them to, you know, do this demonstration? In preparation, how much time do you spend on this?
Well, we had a lot of them where we had to give up, you know, for you start casting, and I think we talked to about 50 of them, and in the end there were 13 in it, and some with fake names, some with real names, some somehow hidden, others there themselves. But it was a very interesting process also, because the cultural center where we did this, they also were very much afraid of the police. They were in the beginning saying, how can you work with policemen? You have to work against them. You have to, because they had grown up in the university at the time when they were beaten up by policemen. So they did not, they wanted to make a play to say police is bad, police is bad. But I think many of our projects try to make it more diverse, more multi-layered, actually, before having a clear message and judge.
Yeah. And besides the policeman, I could notice in the very first part of that work where the participants, six of them, they put on the headphones and then look from afar, from the window. Most of the RP works actually need people to realize it. Without the people, without the participants, the work couldn't be complete. And that's the very interesting part. It is highly experiential. It's highly participatory most of the time.
Yeah, this has become more and more important in our recent projects, that there are often now even projects where we don't have not only not actors, but also that the experts themselves are not directly there. Maybe I can show a little bit an excerpt of a work where we basically use the city as a stage, and the audience is walking through the streets, and it's in this case not a documentary piece, it's a piece about these artificial voices that constantly tell us on GPS where to go and where to walk, and how computers try to predict and assist us in any kind of decisions. So the audience is equipped with headphones and somehow turns into actors themselves.
Welcome to Remote Berlin. My name is Rachel. I sound a bit artificial. Sorry. I am not human, but I will try to be your friend. I'm programmed for you. I'm programmed so that you will always find your way. Let yourself be carried by the music. The others are doing it too. They join you and you flow onwards together.
0 degrees. Turn with the sound, slowly, like a security camera. 90 degrees. Scan your surroundings. 130 degrees.
If you left your thoughts on my hard drive, I could talk to you after your death. Your ideas could live on. But this time without doubts, without pain, without the others.
So basically you're listening to a voice that is telling from the perspective of an artificial intelligence, talking about the human beings, where they struggle, where they fail, where they also gather and become a sort of a group together, and how they socially interact. There is a part where basically we're just standing in a normal supermarket, and the computer voice starts to question, what are these humans doing?
And at the they same try time, to they act towards a each other well. They in were being an almost to make well. As,
I mean, the participants, they become a spectacle as well.
Yes.
They were being looked at.
There is a moment where they sort of, I'll come to that, where they turn into sort of a flash.
This is how humans work, 8 hours a day. Protected by a bubble of politeness. But in the back there are people queuing. Humans make other humans wait. Each one of them hates the person in front of him. Multiplicity is a problem here. On the other side of the supermarket, you can see the future. Over there, nobody has to wait. Customers are served by machines. Machines that communicate. Like me. Now go to the door and it will open for you. Go through and into the public space. I am imagining you and your horde is a political group. A movement. What do you stand for? Look in your bag. Is there anything in there that sets you apart? Take it out and hold it in your hand discreetly, as a slight gesture of difference. Now walk onto the street. Now turn right and walk as a demonstration in front of the cars. Lift up your object above your head. Hold it up so everybody can see it. And already you are a small, non-uniform mass. A potential. The horde has to find its way through the crowd. As a horde, you are strong.
All of this screaming is actually just a binaural recording.
Strange what you are doing, as soon as you are among many others. If
you cut the sound, and if you're standing by and see these people just walking, you won't hear anything.
They are very puzzled. Look puzzled.
I'm doing this with a sound designer that creates sort of a sound environment around your head that you really have the feeling that you are in a demonstration. Mm-hmm. And we... as we're speaking, the shows are going on in Moscow, and it's quite a challenge there, because we're actually doing this scene right in front of the head office of the prosecutor. And in Moscow, as you might have heard, it's not so easy to go demonstrating in the street. Mm-hmm. And the Russian audience is always sort of in this moment when they're asked to hold up their objects, mm-hmm. scaredly looking around, does anybody see me? And then they're doing it and suddenly have this feeling, wow, we can do it, we can do it. And from inside, it feels very threatening. When you look at it from outside, you don't really know what it is. Is it a demonstration? Because it's very silent, and it doesn't have any signs or inscriptions. In this way, the project sort of transforms the city also and creates a sort of a second layer of an audience that sees something which is not exactly a performance, because what you're seeing is actually spectators, but they sort of almost turn into actors.
And I would say it's a rather a theater event instead of in a drama or a performance in a traditional way. It's in fact an event in which you create a situation in real time and space.
I never really know where to draw the line. It's interesting that you're saying this, because in Germany there's a lot of talking about event culture. Is this bad? Or it seems to be a negative thing somehow. I think it's somehow very close to drama, maybe much more than other projects in my case, because in this case it's a clearly written text. There is a sort of a character, which is this artificial intelligence. But on the other hand, there's not an actor. Yeah, that's true. But, medieval times, theater was something that people would walk through villages in long parades, and it wasn't with a stage. I think what we now think is theater in proscenium stages is just something of 200, 300 years. Greek theater was something completely different, and we would probably call it an event today.
The first two examples you showed were, in a sense, humanizing something that most people perhaps would never come across. In the first case, the driver. Mm-hmm. As you say, they tend to be isolated. They tend to be on their own. You don't see drivers. You don't understand them. Second case, police, because in Brazil, in that context, you avoid them.
Mm-hmm.
But this one is very different. This is much more an immersive experience.
Yeah, and I think it probably represents a bit the change or the transformation that some of our projects have taken in the recent times, that we have become more and more interested in what is actually the experience of a spectator. How far can we... Because, my first job when I started working was a journalist, and a lot of this research fed into newspaper articles that then are published and very quickly thrown away. And I felt these researches need to become more, need to leave more impact, or need to also be maybe produced with a bit more time, because I needed to write in 2 hours and publish and go. And so many often complex contents need to be shrinked down to something which then in a TV show is 3 minutes. So experience is maybe a cue to understanding often. So in this case, it's actually really the experience of being dependent on technology to know where to go. And the longer you trust this voice, the more you start to do things that you would never do alone, or where you would think, oh, I don't want to. There's a moment when the audience runs actually through the city suddenly, because they started to build up this confidence. We used a similar kind of technology in a project that you have experienced live. Maybe I show a bit of this, which the term immersive has become even more. But in this time, it's not the city that you immerse. It's a project where we departed, basically, it's called Situation Rooms, and we departed from... That was, maybe you remember this image, that was when Obama shot Osama, or at least he made us believe that he did it somehow, because he was sitting in front of this TV. They're all looking at this one television, and they make us believe that there's one place in the White House from where they can control all crises around the world. And we said, maybe it's a bit too simplified to understand the crises. And especially in our case, we were interested in the weapon trafficking around the world, because Germany is the third biggest manufacturer and exporter of weapon. So we thought we would like to understand what does it mean, this complex international network of people selling weapon to others and creating and stabilizing, as they say, or defending countries. So we created what is it, I think 14 spaces, 14 situation rooms that are connected together to something that from outside looks a bit like a film set. And you immerse into it in the role of 20 different people that found important protagonists for the questions of weapon trafficking. So we did long researches and casting and found a child soldier from Congo, a lawyer from Pakistan defending drone victims. Again, we wanted their stories to be experienceable somehow, but not in a... We knew that we wouldn't be able to bring them together all for a touring theater show. And we filmed video films that you experience in spaces that are reconstructing spaces of where they work or where their biographies have developed. Let me show a little bit of the trailer. It makes it more understandable.
Was braucht man, um in den Krieg zu ziehen? Nachtsichtgerät, feuerfeste Unterwäsche, Splitterschutzweste, Mut, Gottvertrauen, Sanitätsausrüstung und Ausbildung. Man muss eben wissen, dass es immer gefährlich werden kann.
So these people that you see now are audience members, and they are watching films that we shot with these 20 people inside these very rooms. And these rooms are reconstructions then again of real spaces. For instance, this is a shooting range of a German policeman, or but they are, you can build them up in other spaces.
Genevon, ils m'ont ramené aux frontières du Rwanda. Ich mich formen, être Soldat.
Früher habe ich Waschmaschinenteile gemacht. Heute machen wir Hightech-Waffenteile. Und die Arbeit war eigentlich genau das Gleiche.
You know that somewhere over the fence there is someone that actually wants to kill you.
Look at the mirror. I'm a hacker, and now I have another pseudo-body, which is yours.
Anfangs von den 80er Jahren, beim ersten Golfkrieg, da haben sie gezeigt, wie Teheran verteidigt worden ist. Auf einem Hoteldach oben habe ich gesehen, dass da
ein
Geschütz steht.
When I was there, I literally cooked the soup, and I had the chance to drink it. So is that experiential when you participate in this work as an audience member.
Maybe you can talk more about how you experienced it, because it's always, because on video it's difficult to imagine how it really, so you started off in what role, in what character?
I forgot already, but
I... At some point you were the Russian cook, right?
I have been I've taken up many, many roles. I have been a soldier, where at that point of time I had to hold a gun to point at someone, and I have
which wasn't a real gun, which was the...
Of course, it's a toy.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And then I used to be a soldier in a room where I have to raise a national flag. And then suddenly some bombing happened and I have to, squeeze and...
Congolese child soldier. Former child soldier.
So on the one hand, I have to perform some task and duty and experience... what the actual players have been experienced. And at the same time, I could see what's going on in the movie. So I'm taking actually two experiences at the same time.
Because
in the same film
here,
set.
It sometimes looks like as if they were filming, but actually it just looks so because they are the same spaces, but they're actually watching films from the first person perspective of the filmmakers, which are these 20 characters. And you stay 7 minutes in each character, and then you would swap from Indian fighter pilot to Israeli soldier to Mexican drug cartel murder, actually.
And it's one kind of immersive theater, as you could say, but the interesting thing is the people that I encounter are not performers. They are the other audience members who play with me in the very same film set. So when I bump into a banker from the Switzerland, the Bank of Switzerland, he or she was actually someone who joined with me in the audience member. He paid the same price, the ticket, and joined the performance.
Because there are 20 spectators at a time, they can see it. Every 2 hours, 20 people can go in, and each one starts with one roll off, and then you swap every 7 minutes. And as these 7 minutes, they were filmed in the exactly same moment, every time, basically the same things happen every 7 minutes, but always with different characters. And so all the others are exactly where the extras are. But I always struggle when I try to explain it.
It's a very complicated thing. And the very first thing that I recall after seeing the show is that it was a mathematics. The whole thing is just a math.
It's actually a huge Excel sheet where the script is a sort of a... Yeah, it's something we experience often, that the when you come from theater scripting, which classically a drama text, you know, it starts here with the description of the roles and then it's the lines and basically it says maybe what needs to be on stage. But what we often write in Excel sheets, actually, rather, where when this happens, then this happens, and in the same moment this needs to happen and this happens, but on the other side of the wall, and this... you need to throw a little ball into a hole, and it is then has meaning for the person on the other side of the wall. A lot of this kind of network scripting happens. Yeah.
Geschütz gsi, wo mir seinerzeit im Schlag geliefert händ.
Мы сейчас уберем тарелку со стола.
Walk over to him and say hello. Ujambo. Habari zako. Sasa niambie.
كيف انا وصلت لهم من جميع انحاء حمص توجهوا الناس لساحة الساعة ليعملوا مثل هاي المظاهرة وأملنا كان بالتغيير.
انا غادي ديكو يا دي كو دي بال et des professeurs paniqués. Par terre, par terre! Tout d'un coup, il y avait des militaires qui sont rentrés. Ils ont commencé à tabasser des professeurs, torturer des professeurs à mort. Donc moi, j'ai cherché à fuir là. Ils m'ont récupéré, ils m'ont dit, non, maintenant, c'est pas vos papas qui sont soldats, maintenant, c'est vous.
And I have to confess, I took selfie in one of the rooms. Because in a way, it's really a spectacular. You're making some spectacles within each room, and I just can't help.
You thought you'd never be a soldier again, and so take a selfie as yourself as a.
But you see, this piece. I mean, for some of your work, I would say it's quite demanding on the audience members. But of course, it's fun and it's playful. But
it's special with this that I mean in a certain way often our audience already knows that they are gonna be experience something more than just sitting down in the dark and admiring people in the light. But we then also get other audiences that would never go to theater because here and it's also a bit of a misunderstanding sometimes productive sometimes. That some people even come that sort of come from this world of video gaming, you know, that right. They feel that it's something that has to do with this, I open a door and I get into a next level and I open the next door and it is a little bit of it and then again not because video games are, as much as they promise to be immersive, they are still quite frontal as far as I've experienced, and the movie industry has been promising us 3D movies for a long while, and all what happens is you sit down with these ridiculous glasses and it sort of looks a little bit 3D, but it's... So in the end, it's very theater then again, because you are walking, and that's maybe demanding, but on the other hand, sometimes when I sit in theater, I also find it very demanding to be forced to sit down and just not move and be silent. And
yeah.
It's not my world so much, yeah.
What you're describing, to my mind, the next obvious step is virtual reality. You're in a sense anticipating that because you're creating a world around them. You're putting them in that context. You're taking away their experience by controlling the vision.
I hope the other way around. I think it's very. I think it might look, that's why the video gamers come as something virtual, but it's very real. I had a big argument 3 weeks ago with a producer in Paris where we did this remote project, and I really wanted the people to cross a street where it's not exactly legal to cross the street, but it's also, on the other hand, not really dangerous. But she, as the producer, said, no, but they can't. And I sort of was angry because I didn't want to make this scene more complicated by walking all the way around the traffic lights. But on the other hand, I sort of understood her panic because it's very real. The cars might then, in the experience of the sound design and of the group experience and of the drive you get into with the soundscapes, might feel very virtual, but obviously there could be accidents. Somebody broke the arm in the running scene in Moscow some weeks ago, and so it is real. And sometimes people then suddenly take off the headphone and think, oh, I had in Hamburg a spectator who, after the first round of Situation Room, suddenly said, no, I don't want to do it anymore because I don't want to be a weapon dealer, not even in a theater play, not even pretending to be. It somehow felt so real to him, whereas this obviously wasn't real. He was not trafficking, he was not committing anything immoral or something, but it suddenly felt so much real. But it's all about this confusion, obviously, of our cohabitation with augmented reality that is around us all the time. But both of these projects actually are not at all dealing with augmented reality. They might feel like it, but it's actually very low tech in the end. It's the stage designer was working very long to create the materials to look as if the space was.
Even if there are role-playing, or even if there are formal experiments, or very rebelliously redefining the form of theatre, there are serious issues supporting the whole thing. Like in Situation Room, you're investigating the weapon industry. How the 14 rooms came into being are based on extensive research, and you actually reenact the room of the weapon dealers having coffee over chocolate and to kind of discuss the catalogue of weapons. You reenact the actual situation of that very dialogue from your research. So they are very real to me.
Yeah. Maybe we can have a little look into a project that is called Kolkata in a Box, where something that often feels very virtual becomes very real. It's a project that we developed in India, where a lot of call centers are situated for England and the US as well. And people there are normally thinking, when they're on the phone, suddenly receiving a phone call trying to sell them something, that these people are somewhere around the corner, because actually that's what they're told to say. They're not allowed to give away their real names. They're not called Arjun on the telephone, but they're called John. They're expected to know what the weather situation in London or in New York or wherever they're calling is like. And we wanted to turn this a bit around and make it a real conversation. So when you wanted to see the project, you were somewhere, for instance, in Poland, and in the theater they would give you a key to a room. Inside that room, the phone is ringing.
Hello.
Hello. Am I speaking to Monica?
Yes, exactly.
Hello. This is Sharmishta from Calcutta.
Hi.
Hi. How are you?
Quite fine.
Hello. Hi. This is Aditya Maria. We're speaking.
Yes, it is.
Hi. Which part of your name you are calling by? Maria or Aditya?
You can call me Aditya.
Hallo Ilse, ich heiße schon Theodor. Ich verstehe, dass Sie an mich zu mir kommen zu sprechen, aber es gibt keine Visitenkarte da. Macht doch nicht.
Eine Visitenkarte?
Ja.
Ah ja.
Yeah? Luisa, where are you sitting right now? Are you sitting in front of the computer or are you sitting somewhere else?
In front of the computer now.
So yeah. Why don't you sit on the sofa that we have for you on the other side of the room? It's a very comfortable sofa that we have arranged for.
Yeah? Yeah. Okay. I try.
And
the sofa, it looks nice.
Yeah.
So, yeah. And yeah, it's nice.
The first thing I would do as an Indian would be to offer you something warm to drink. Can I offer you some tea? Would you like that?
That's really nice. And I have problems with the water here. I don't think it works, the kettle. But it's nice to offer me tea.
Shall we try and see? If it doesn't work, it doesn't. And then I can arrange for tea for some by some other way.
Yes, I don't think it works because I tried it just before you called to turn it on.
Okay, don't do anything. Just stay away.
Okay, I won't do anything. Oh, now it works. It
yeah,
works now.
See, it's waiting for me. It needs the Indian touch.
And the Indian touch, in this case, it's a USB connection that allows the Indian performers to remote control certain things, to cook tea in the office where you are, but also to switch on music, to cut the light, to trigger a heater, to produce Indian heat, to print pictures.
Oh, it's okay.
You received the picture?
Yes.
Okay. This picture is of a lady, yeah?
Yeah. Washing something in...
Washing something, absolutely. So she is my housemaid, yeah? She works for us. So she's a nice lady. And here in India, we are very privileged to, you know, get people who help us in our household work.
Because in Germany, actually, call center operator is a very badly paid job. In India, it's a very well-paid job. And the part of the sort of surprise to the German or Polish audience is that the people on the other side actually have people at their homes working for them. They're a high-degree university students with a good quality foreign language skills. And so you start to sort of change the perception of the people on the other side of the line. They also start to draw
a
picture
on the table as well.
Of how they might look
so
like.
Why don't you try and draw me as well? Let's see.
And
without seeing each other, how do we imagine ourselves?
Again, you might ask, is this all scripted? And
so
I have to say it's...
Yes, maybe
it's
yellow.
It's very few of it is scripted, but it has a dramaturgical line that goes through it. Certain things are happening in certain moments. For instance, singing is a part.
Keep your eyes closed.
Yeah.
And I'll sing you a song.
Mm-hmm.
Tum pukar lo tumhara intezaar hai tum pukar.
Oh, well, I guess someone's looking at me right now.
Yeah, somebody is.
I see a picture on the screen with an eye.
Okay. Oh, I didn't tell you what my name means.
No, what does your name mean?
Su means goat. Naina means
yes?
Eye. So in Sanskrit, the word means she who sees very well.
What you do? Tell me, Frederico, can you see a plant on a wooden box on your table?
You know the little wooden box with the plant in it?
Yes.
You just lift the whole thing up.
Lift the plant out of the box?
No, the box as well. Both of them.
Oh.
Hello. Hi.
Hi.
Ta-da! Now you enter the stage.
Hi.
Hi.
So suddenly the person that got very close to you through the time, and there were about 15 different performers in India, so it was a bit by chance whom you got to talk to. Suddenly, very much to the end actually, they started having a face and they would also start to show you around their office space.
Yes. So I will show you my office space.
So now I leave the camera and now you will see rows of people. Can you sit?
Speaking to Mrs. Lois Gregson.
So the other people working just right next to our operators were actually people who were selling mobile phones to Australia there. And they had very target-oriented sort of jobs to sell. They would applaud whenever they would sell something to the others, and it was quite a hierarchical structure.
We also sell mobiles.
And ours had often much more fun also in the... They were often jealously looking over when they saw them suddenly dancing with the screen, for instance.
Yeah, okay.
So have you also spent quite a lot of time
in that
Calcutta call center as a
field
research?
I'm putting my hand.
Yeah, we spent quite some time there.
Yes.
And, some of the performers were actually former call center employees, but many of them didn't want to work with us because they have quite a tricky system to keep you inside the company. You know, you earn a little bit more every year, and so the people didn't want to step out of their jobs.
And voila.
And it's interesting to see how you transform this usual experience, daily experience of, you know, calling up to a call center. You kind of reframe it and make it extraordinary and quite unusual. Kind of exemplifies this relationship between us and the call center.
Yeah, and the conversation really became quite... we needed to install a countdown, as you will see there. Because it started to go, it would have gone on the conversations in an uncontrollable way. And obviously, then again, we are also theater directors and authors and need to also organize that the next audience gets their performance. So we had this countdown.
So let's count together. 5, 4.
To end this after exactly 50 minutes.
Bye bye.
And this was a very strange moment when the call ended, because you normally at the end of a show you have this applause and then you can go to the bar and talk to the actors. But here it suddenly was then when you really realized that the others were 20,000 kilometers away and you were somehow in a different life and in different circumstances.
Yeah.
Is it clear how this worked, more or less? So this show was actually done many, many, many, many times, actually throughout 2 years in different cities, because it's a one-on-one thing. So in order to make it somehow work, we also benefited from the fact that globalization has so different living costs in India. And although we paid our call center operators 3 times more than a doctor in India, it was still not so much money for, so it sort of could work with normal theater tickets in Germany or England or wherever we did it.
Looking at Alpi's work, at times I recall my experience in appreciating other contemporary artwork. One of the examples I would like to raise is from Taiwan, Chen Gaiyan, Chen Jieren. There's a Taiwan visual artist who also employed most of the time in his work. He worked mostly on film and installation. And most of the time he employed non-professional actors, that's a social actors, I would say, to participate in his work. For example, in one work called Factory, Gia Gong Chong, he rented a deserted factory and invited all the unemployed all the laid off factory workers to go back to that very site. And
like a ghost dream or a
To revisit and to ask them to work every day. And he observed them and for several months before turning on the camera to shoot them in that very factory. And that visual turns out is less than documentary. The camera is not following the lives of that garment factory workers, but kind of frame them in a way, in a more poetic and atmospheric representation of the desolate space, of the despair of the unemployed. So your work always reminds me of my experience in contemporary art. I associate more of your work to art forms like visual arts rather than the usual theatre that we've engaged ourselves in.
It's a project where we try to, for once, not make a portrait of call centre operators or muezzins or truck drivers, all of these specific groups, we tried for once to represent the entire city on a stage. So it's called 100% City, in this case 100% Melbourne. When you want to have the city on stage, you need to look at numbers first of all. So Melbourne has 50-50 male, female. So on our stage, we wanted to have 50 men and 50 women. I don't know how it is in Hong Kong with it's about 50-50, yeah? In Russia, for instance, it would be much more female, yeah? Here, we'll hear that tomorrow, because tomorrow I'm meeting somebody from the statistics office, I believe. Then we have in Melbourne a lot of immigrants, and quite some of them, I think, where is it? Asia, I think it's 3% Northeast Asia, 3% South. So we only had, I think, 76 or something Australian-born Australians in Melbourne on the stage. And we also have all the age groups from, these are the babies, the grown-up. In Switzerland, we had much more old people still than in Melbourne, but it's not, you know, it's already, I guess Hong Kong would also be a younger society, you know? That's just me guessing, yeah? The neighborhoods are represented on stage according to the numbers and civil, in this case it was household size, yeah. Sometimes we take also if married, divorced, or single households. According to these figures then, we try to find 100 people to be on stage, and we do this through a chain reaction. We start normally with a statistician, and in Melbourne it was him.
For example, if you look at Hume City in residential location, there are four boxes. That's because there are 4% of Melburnians live in Hume City. Now, I've never been to Hume City except to go to or from the airport, and I don't know anyone from there. But we needed to find four people from our 100 to represent the city. So we started a chain reaction. For me, it was very easy. I was number one, so I could simply choose anyone and fill in the boxes. I chose my friend Michael. He's between 25 and 34, lives in Inner Melbourne, and he's here tonight.
I brought along my camera that I bought 20 years ago. Recently, I went to the Solomon Islands to photograph Australian volunteers, and I brought along friend John.
I'm wearing my grandfather's tummy. I've survived the running the bulls, and I brought along my lovely and single sister, Lauren.
I'm 28. I live in South Melbourne. I've got moves you've never seen.
So in the beginning, you can see only, I think, 20 to 35-year-olds. That's a problem. So soon this category is full. And then we started to find, we needed to change a bit, correct the chain reaction, and got the first, in the Italian community actually, we found the first older people. Soon after, I think this is the first Chinese we had on stage.
My name's Xavier, I'm 5 years old, this is my county, and I'm only little.
So the children come in, and the first scene basically is just everybody presenting themselves, and it's a long scene, but it never gets boring because you see face after face how diverse the community is, how different people are together. And I just come back from Malaysia now, where we did 100% Penang with 51% Chinese immigrants and I think only 32% Malay. And 9% Indian born, and so you get to see a lot of very different faces. Towards the end of the chain reaction, it becomes really complex, because then I think the last ones we needed in Melbourne were, I think, from Eastern Europe, old people from a certain neighborhood. So then we need to start calls through newspapers, through radio stations, but we managed in the end to get them all together and to be able
and
to represent the age chart, for instance.
Right, now we will all take one step back for each 10 years of our age,
Seeing that I'm 88 year old, I will take 8 steps back. Already. Turn steady. Go.
So this is a vertical camera, and here you can see physically the statistic of the age groups represented. But we also ask different things on the stage. For instance, how does a city behave all day long?
Melbourne at 9 p.m.
Melbourne at 10 p.m.
We only have about 5
Melbourne
rehearsals.
Melbourne at 11 p.m.
5 rehearsals in each city, so we don't really rehearse how they should do it. Or
Melbourne at midnight.
We basically just tell them, look, when you go to sleep, you go on the floor, and Melbournians
sleep. Melbourne at 1 a.m.
They sleep quite early because they want to get up early in the morning to do sport. But some keep dancing.
Melbourne at 2 a.m.
Let's see how they get up in the morning. That's the
night. A.m.
Melbourne at 6 a.m.
Melbourne at 7 a.m.
Melbourne at 8 a.m.
So basically it's a very simple idea. It's basically you draw a sample of the society and then you ask a
Melbourne
question and you get 100 answers. And they might be more or less representative, they might not be. We can't really double check
Melbourne
because there's no statistics about what people do at what time of the day. But probably it sort of looks like if it could be real. We also ask a lot of questions.
Afraid to admit something private about themselves.
Who is afraid to admit something private about themselves? And now on the right side you have a sign saying not me. And on the left side it says me. It's a bit small there, but you can see that there.
Who lost a friend last week?
Who lost a friend last week?
Who has cried this year?
Who's afraid of the future?
Who believes in life after death?
These questions come into being. Who wrote these questions?
So, some questions we bring along, and some others. There is actually open mic. I can show a bit of the open mic where they just can ask whatever they want. You saw it in Malaysia, and we were not so satisfied with the open.
Who catches public transport?
Yeah, and I think in Melbourne there was some. Let me see. I think
who loves Justin Bieber?
So that's what you get when you open the mic.
And one night you stand on the left and then
who
the other night you can
change
your vote.
Who believes we should change the Australian flag?
Who believes we should change the Australian flag? That's an interesting question for Hong Kong because it still has the Queen sign in the flag. Sorry.
Who here believes in climate change?
Which in Australia you can still ask it that way. In the rest of the world they know it's a fact. In Australia you don't get too many. Yeah.
Who likes a
yeah. Then there are other rules as well, where we ask basically to build group pictures. We have broken the law, that's the group. We have been in jail. There were three. In Malaysia, we did not get one for this question for some reason. Which is as representative as you can.
That's the interesting part of it.
Yeah, we don't know if they're telling the truth. There is a question, who lied tonight? And often some hands are up, but in Malaysia, I think in Penang, there were only about 8 hands up or something like that.
So it's fun. It started off with objective statistics, but as it progresses, it becomes kind of a subjective projection of individual voices. And there's tension between, you know, objective, subjective, and in the end, it's all about individuals speaking up for themselves. It's kind of engaging in a way.
What is also interesting in this project is that the way that people observe the show is very, on one hand, you get quite a loud audience because they do comment. We had in Penang people applauding like crazy when a big majority on stage said that the local governor is corrupt, and a big applause to the people saying that. And on the other hand, it's also a project where everyone comes with a different agenda why to watch it, because there are a lot of people in the audience that know somebody on stage, want to see where will he go? Will he be part of the group who says they're in favor of the death penalty or not? Now we can look a little bit into the Asian version of it. This was Gwangju, the same scene. South Korean Gwangju, not Chinese. In the scripting of the questions, and I think that's a bit what we might be working in the workshop about as well. You need to obviously also react to what do people want to be asked or not. What might they be willing to give away of them? Questions like drugs, for instance, in Malaysia would be impossible to ask, where in Amsterdam we could openly ask and get about 20 or 30% saying that they've tried drugs. It was the only foreigner, actually. There's only 1%. It's such a homogeneous community in South Korea. And he had been to jail because he was a refugee from Africa. So in South Korea, we found quite a lot of questions that we figured out we cannot ask them in public. So I think it was one of the first cities where we invented the dark scene, where people just answer with flashlights.
실직한 적이 있거나 지금 실직 상태에 있는 분.
Which is a question in Germany you would obviously ask it with no problem in the public. Now everybody is showing with a flashlight if they have been unemployed. And in South Korea, this is something you don't want to face.
가정폭력 사례를 직접적으로 알고 계신 분.
Yeah, we keep changing it according to.
회초리로 아이를 때려본 적이 있는 분.
So despite the framework and the structure is the same for every city, you kind of recontextualize it with the questions.
And we discover certain questions are relevant in the society, in the rehearsals, because we do with small groups ask them also to suggest questions, and then somebody asked this question: who has been beaten with a stick? And we were shocked by the result. We couldn't believe that it was almost everybody had been beaten with a stick at home, which in Germany you would get. I don't know who has been beaten with a stick here. Hands up. I'm in there. Okay.
We can do a vault here.
Okay. That's now lights out.
Okay. I think we're running out of time. So, do you have more any more cases to share? And in time for you guys to share some of your thoughts and, of course, your experience.
I'm just curious, because you're representing this tonight, obviously, as a very successful concept, but it's not an orthodox cultural idea. So I can't imagine when you first started trying to get it off the ground that people understood what you were trying to do. So I'm curious as to when you started doing it, what the reaction was like from potential funding bodies or donors or even venues, and how that's changed over the years.
You're talking particularly about 100%, or you're talking
generally about the concept of theatre that doesn't take place in a theatre and involves the public?
Yeah, we started out basically trying out things, and we were actually quite lucky to, I don't know, when I studied theatre, that was sort of in the 90s, where a lot of formalist approaches were out there in the world, and it seemed that this idea to experiment light at its most extreme, or loud music, or no music, or silence for a very long time, all these formal experiments that were so much part of what 90s avant-garde did, came a bit to an empty routine, I don't know. So I think when we started to invite basically people that had simple stories of their lives to tell on stage, which were a bit our first projects, there was quite soon quite an interest for it. But obviously we did it with very close to no budget, and in simple ways. And as we went on and on, projects became more complex and also more costly and needed more co-producers. But some of the projects were very simple. I mean, I did my first audio tours in the 2001. Was it basically with a Walkman? It costed nothing. You could just do it. It was basically more the idea to say, let's say something. It was maybe a bit our trick, if you want, so that we insisted in calling it theater, because you were right when you were saying that much of it might just as well be named visual arts project, or just call it project, whatever it is. Or somebody once even told me, this is like this audio tour thing, it's like invisible architecture. Okay, maybe. Yeah, you could find different names, but for us, in a way, it was, we came from our interest in theater. We came also from the idea that theater is something which is interesting because you focus for a while on time, on sharing time together, and that gives a bit of a space that often the visual arts crowd don't have maybe that much in this more event-driven speed of vernissage, attention span.
You still employ sounds and visuals and light as punctuation. You have very strong narrative structure, despite you allow things to happen in an organic way, as you said, situation. You create suspenses and surprises as well. So whenever I participate in your work, I would think, okay, I experienced curiosity and imagination again. And I think that these two elements is very important in a theatrical experience. And one time I told Ki Hong that, okay, RP turned me into a child again in your work. And I think this kind of transformation is a kind of like a long-lost touch in the theatre-going experience. And I think in RP's work, you achieve that. And after all, to me, it's a totally theatrical experience, despite all the formal experiments and bombardments.
Remote AIDS in Belgium this May. And I truly agree that this is a very theatrical piece to me as a participant. Because it's, the narrative is, I mean, the text is very well written. A lot of suspense, surprises, and in the end, you lead us experience a climax, you know, when we were in the rooftop of a building and pretending there's some crowds, we experienced that. And so I won't say that it's an event. After I experienced that, I find that it's very theatrical to me. And honestly, before I experienced Remote X, I expecting something like a community project or something like that. But after I experienced that, it's totally another thing. But then I have a question about how you think about the spectators. Okay, and as an audience, I become an actor in Remote X, right? I'm experienced that, and I'm doing what you instructed us, the audience, to do. Okay, we do the protest on the street, right? The demonstration thing, and a lot we dance in a mall, okay? But then, how do you think about the others watching us? I mean, the people on the street, you know, how's the relationship between the spectators and the audience as actors? You know, to me, there's three levels. Actors, audience, and audience. You know what I mean? I'm very curious about this relationship.
Yeah, I personally always hesitate a bit to describe the process as a process of turning into an actor, because but many people have done so. Like critics, when they write, often they say you become an actor in the piece, and we sometimes even say similar things inside the text. But I would say as a part of a fiction, because whoever observes you then walking with your object or running or dancing in a silent way, they would be very cryptic actors. They wouldn't be. So I wouldn't really. They create you. You become maybe actors in the sense of I like the English word act, which doesn't, because in German it says Darsteller or Schauspieler, which is a term that I find awful. It means show player basically, and this part of representativeness I don't think you have. You do act in the sense of. Agere, no, it's a Latin word, like you do something. It's but you don't, in most of the cases, you don't really pretend to do something, and then again, your audience is a very unfocused, almost random flash mob kind of audience. Yeah, you become, I mean, in a very simple way, you become active. But it is still like you are more acting for yourself. You're acting in your own film. And maybe you're acting for the other 49 spectators that are walking along that make you feel like in a crowd. But I'm, on the other hand, also not a theorist, so I wouldn't dare really to do a scientific description of the term actor. What I can say is that the most of the experience that people take away with is more, it feels more almost like being in a film, and you're sort of the camera, and what I as an author sort of deliver to you is the soundscape to your film. And then again, it's not really a film because it's reality, but it feels suddenly, that's why the project is called Remote, it feels suddenly remote, it feels distant, like if you were in a film, in a way. That's how far I got in understanding my own work. I don't know.
Thank you very much. Actually, I enjoy the soundscapes a lot. The soundscape is really well done in Remote. Thanks a lot.
To what extent, because you're manipulating people, can you get people to do things they wouldn't normally do in a public situation like dancing in a mall or, you know, obviously it's a deliberate part of the act, but how much is the psychology of that situation part of what you're trying to achieve?
Yeah, it's there was a time that I haven't really actively experienced in the 70s, but in my studies, sort of, we heard about the participative form of, you know, the living theater and all the kind of theaters that sort of a bit forced you into actions that you might not really want to go on stage in that moment and be exposed as the imperialist or whatever that you were. Or Augusto Boal sort of also rather forced a certain participation often onto people that didn't really know where they would go into. Or also there are contemporary examples of, I would say, comparable work. Sigma, I don't know, maybe somebody might be familiar with their work that is also highly immersive, but you're sort of a bit exposed to a situation where you suddenly have a role and the actors clearly have more power because they know where it leads to, and you don't really. So in these situations, I, as a spectator, actually get quite reluctant to the participation. So I guess the seduction that you're asking is really a process of building up a certain trust that we're not asking you to do something that you would feel awkward with in the end. But it is a build up thing that really actually I often see audience members in the beginning having on their headphone only on one side and sort of standing a bit apart from the group, and then as they're going they realize actually, oh, it's actually fun, and the more I take part in it, the more fun I have, and I also do it a little bit for the others, and then they start to do things which actually in the beginning they would never have thought probably that they would have done because they have built up that kind of mutual trust.
In my experience, like, for example, in Situation Room, I witnessed a lady, she actually gave it up in the middle of the show. And she just sat there in the boardroom until the end of it. So
talk to her. Why she left her?
No, she feels so baffled at that time. But, I mean, we participants have total freedom and we don't feel like being forced at all in engaging is like something of, like an experiment, no, not at all, right?
Yeah, you have different. Maybe the main point is that you're not like, if I would ask, I don't know, you stand, come here and stand here and do something, then you would have 100 people watching you, and it would feel probably awkward if you wouldn't know where I'll take you to. Whereas in our experiences, the situation is everybody is immersed, so you're not really, you're doing it more for yourself as well as
and for fun.
I guess, yeah. And then, I mean, that's the basic rule I once learned from a game programmer that we worked with in Vancouver. He said, whenever you, it's about the game. And I like the word play theater because it implies a certain game idea. Mm-hmm. And when you program a game, he said, you always need for each thing that you want the player to do, you need to give him a bonus, and he obviously gives lives or points or whatever. But I think in theater, you will compensate by experience.
Yes.
So you will give them something to see. There's a door that, or they will get to the next level, in the sense that they see another space, that mm-hmm. they see something more.
Mm-hmm. And perhaps one last question from Ivor.
So what I think is fantastic about your work is the thread of using the technology to humanize people. So in perhaps a lot of modern theater, we see technology as a kind of dehumanizing element or distancing element, particularly in stage theater. But it's very impressive that you managed to maintain the technology as just a tool to let you humanize these people. For example, with the call center, that you have this long-distance communication which enables you to humanize this person which you would normally think of as not even human, right? And the police as well, that you bring them close to the audience and that you use these methods to make them accessible and human. So I just wonder if you could talk about the process of how you work in collaboration with other people and things to make the technology serve the purpose of maintaining a human element in something theatrical like this?
Yeah, basically, I think it's just starting from the essence of the work is still somehow similar as I was working as a journalist. I basically go up to people that interest me, and I think they have a story to tell, and I start asking questions, and if I find story, then I start thinking, how can I... But I, maybe I don't stop then by, thank you, that's the story, I'll go at home and I write it. Or if I would be a film editor, I just shoot it and then edit it and disconnect it again from the person. But I think of either developing together a strategy where they can themselves directly tell the story, or to kind of develop a certain rule how they would offer their, yeah, in situation rooms, their shoes in a way to step into, how they, it was quite a journey together with this Mexican, this was a really complex casting process. We wanted to have somebody from South American kind of little gangster fights, not only the big tanks selling companies in it, and I had a contact through a workshop to Mexico, and for some reason I got into this contact with a guy who really worked in a cartel, and as I quite quickly found out, had killed several people and hadn't been enough to jail for what he had done. But through the Skype, sort of, I got him into, well, or we sort of started to trust each other, and I bought him this ticket to come to Berlin and to work 3 weeks with us. And it was quite an intense process where he took a long journey away from what he's normally doing and sort of also go into a reflective position with, because he had then the camera in his hand where he would normally have the gun, and he would explain to somebody else that he wouldn't meet on the, that would later listen to it on a headphone, why and what he was doing. And I don't know what, I haven't really had so much more contact afterwards. I didn't deliver him to the police, which for a while I thought I should have maybe done, but I thought that would be like breaking our trust. But anyway, he then had gone through an experience that might have also given him a distance or a possibility to question it. I don't know if it's the case. I don't know what he's doing now. On the other hand, we don't really, yeah, I can't really say that it's not social work that we're doing, but it does, you need to work with the people very much, more than just doing an interview and go.
Right. Unfortunately, we have to stop here, but I'm sure there are a lot of reflections going on right now in our minds, especially in terms of the tools of theatre that RLP is employing in comparison to our usual notion of theatre. Tomorrow and the day after tomorrow, we have two sessions of workshops at the Catadepo Artist Village. And afterwards, the West Kowloon will also document the content of the workshops and the dialogue on their website.
And please start to think about what questions would you like to ask to a representative sample of your city. What would you like to get 100 answers from Hong Kong? And I'll be very open and interested
to write to us
and suggest questions.
Thank you very much. If you would thank join you. Me to thank Stefan Kegi from Rimini Protocol and V. Leung from On and On.